right now, and we can all come together somewhere, somehow.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim. Bismillahi r-Rahmani r-Rahim. Walakad karramna bani Adama wa hamalnahum fil barri wal bahr wa razaqnahum min at-tayyibat wa fadhalnahum ala kathirin mimman khalaqna tafdila. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. The topic of my talk is human dignity and Islamic perspective. In the Quran, in Surah Al-Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 70, the verse which I recited in the beginning, Allah says, وَلَكَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَرَزَقْنَاهُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا تَفْضِيلًا. Indeed, we have honored the human race, the children of Adam, and we have carried them over the sea and over land, and we have provided them with all provisions, and we have made them above and better than many of our creatures. This is the basic theme of my presentation today. It will be divided, Allah willing, into two parts. One is to look at the universality of the concept of human dignity in Islam. Secondly, that we find the routine and foundation of the concept of human dignity within the boundaries and purposes of Islamic Sharia, that is, Islamic divine law. Let us first speak about the issue of universality. And here, there are five basic points that need to be made. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dignified the human race by creating the human. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah At-Tin, chapter number 95, verse number 4, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Indeed, we have created man in the best of molds. In the best of molds physically, in the best of molds intellectually, in the best of molds also in terms of spirituality in the human being. Spirituality that has been described in the Quran as a divine breath that Allah breathed into the human, something of His spirit that is a part of human nature. Secondly, that we find evidence in the Quran of that honor bestowed upon the human race by the fact that Allah commanded the angels to bow down to Adam alayhi salam when He created him. Angels that are totally pure and that are never disobedient to Allah, as it is mentioned in the Quran in Surah At-Tahrim, chapter number 66, verse number 8-6, لَا يَعْسُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. They obey Allah whatever He commands them, and they do as they are commanded. Yet, they are ordered to bow down. Not bow down, but they worship to bow down by the way of respect and honor to Adam alayhi salam. Why is that? Because the human has the power of choice alongside the jinn. Human has the power of choice to obey Allah and not to disobey Allah. And when the human exerts himself to obey Allah, then it deserves honor. Third point, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the human race by appointing every human being and appointing them collectively as His trustees or khulafas or vicegerent on this earth. As it is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 30. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Behold, thy Lord said to the angels, I will create a vicegerent on earth. And He created him, not because He needs the help of anyone, that He appointed him or her as His trustee. But this is the symbol of dignity and the consequences of responsibility for the human being. The fourth element of universality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dignified the human race by making everything in the universe for the service and benefit of mankind. As Allah says in Surah Al-Jathiyah, chapter number 45, verse number 13, وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْهُ. Allah made subservient for your benefits everything in heaven and earth. Some some of those things which made subservient to the human are subject to the immediate command or control of the human, such as the control that Allah has given the human over animals. Some are also made subservient to the human, but in a different meaning, like the sun, the moon. You do not move the sun and the moon in the way you like. But what it means is that Allah created them, subjected them for the purpose of serving mankind and providing them with the means of living. Furthermore, we also find evidence in the Quran that if indeed Allah were to hold mankind and punish them because of their violation, by depriving all his bounties, nobody will be kept alive. As Allah says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 61. وَلَوْ يُعَقِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِظُلْمِهِمْ مَا تَرَكَ عَلَيْهَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ. If Allah were to hold people and punish them because of their violation, nothing will be kept alive on this earth. It is out of the bounty of Allah that He provides for all, believers, non-believers, at least at one basic level. That's why He is called Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman, that He is merciful to all, believers, non-believers. But this does not mean that we would have the same in the hereafter. But this is out of the mercy of Allah, Rahmah, His mercy and compassion that include all living things. It shows the mercy of Allah of giving a chance also to those who reject Him, to go back, to have their conscience stimulated and awakened, and try to see all those blessings and reciprocate by obedience to Him, following of His path before it's too late for them.
An example by which we abide.
Now, we move on to the second part of my talk, that is the concept of human dignity within the boundaries and purposes of Islamic Sharia. It was concluded, and this is the kind of consensus among scholars based on the reading of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and trying to ascertain overall objective of Islamic Sharia. The ultimate objective of Islamic Sharia is to safeguard five major things in that order: to safeguard faith, to safeguard life, to safeguard mind, to safeguard honor, to safeguard wealth and property. Let us examine each of these areas and relate them to the concept of human dignity. On the method of safeguarding faith, there are three basic areas that we can derive from the primary resources of Islam. First, that we can look at the safeguarding of faith in a positive sense is by giving the human beings the opportunity and the privileges and honor to believe in, submit to, and love the Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By the fact that the human being is endowed with a pure innate nature, described in the Quran in Surah Ar-Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 30. Fitrat Allahi lati fatara an-nasa alayha. The nature made by Allah in which He has made man. Secondly, the human being is also endowed with the power to think, to reason, as we read in the Quran in Surah Al-Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 23. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. And made for you the faculties of hearing, seeing, feeling, and understanding. Little thanks it is that He give. Thirdly, even with these bounties that are in themselves sufficient for the person to know and relate the Creator out of His mercy, Allah has also sent prophets and messengers throughout history to guide the humankind in terms of actions and in beliefs. The second area in purpose of Islamic Sharia is to safeguard life. And here, there are two basic points to remember. First is the sanctity of human life, as Allah says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, verse number 32. مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Killing one's soul without a justifiable reason is like killing the whole of mankind. And saving one life is like saving the whole of humankind. Secondly, to affirm the sanctity of human life, Islam forbids suicide. Committing suicide, why? Because we do not own the life and the health that we have. It is a gift from Allah. It is a trust in our hands. And the real owner is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator. So we have no right to dispose of our life. As it is mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 195. وَلَا تُلْكُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّحْلُكَةِ. and make not your own hands contribute to your destruction. The third area in purpose of Islamic Sharia, which relates to safeguarding of mind, and here there are two basic points to remember. First, we see that on the positive sides also, that Islam requires us to learn education for both male and female. In Islam, it is not regarded as a right, but as a duty, as it is mentioned in a hadith of Ibn Majah, the book of Sunnah, hadith number 224. Seeking knowledge is mandatory on every Muslim. In fact, the very first word revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Iqra. Recite. The first few ayah, verses revealed to the Prophet, peace be upon him, speak about the pen and its value. On the negative sides, as a mean of respecting the human mind, we find that respecting the mind is also to prohibit anything that will tamper the mind. That's why Islam forbids drugs and intoxicants and anything that tampers the mind. As it is mentioned in Surah Al-Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, innama al-khamru wal-maisiru wal-ansabu wal-azlam ridzum min amal al-shaytan fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun. O you who believe, intoxicants and gambling, dedication of stones and divination by arrows are an abomination of Satan's handiwork. Eschew such abominations that he may prosper. The human mind that would be used for something more beneficial. The fourth category, traditionally the scholars called it Hamayatul Ard. How do we understand Ard? Some understood it to mean a reference to morality. But in fact, it's more than that. Who can find evidence in the Quran and the Sunnah that also safeguard the honor of the humans? His or her dignity as a human. We find that, for example, in terms of social relationship, Islam requires mutual relationship not only among Muslims, but also with the respect of other people. People also of other faith, as long as they are not committing any aggression against Muslims. It is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 2, the book of funerals, hadith number 1312. At the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time in Medina, the funeral procession of a Jew was passing by. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood. Somebody said, "This is the funeral of a Jew." The Prophet responds, "Alaysat nafsan? Is it not a soul?" We find the prohibition in slander in attack of others, the respect of equality and justice, political participation is part and parcel, also with respect of human dignity. Finally, the fifth topic, that is the safeguarding of wealth, that is the right to own property, to enjoy it, and protect it through various punitive actions, those who are aggressive against the property of others. But in meantime, also realizing that what we have is a trust from Allah and provided, and everything in the universe, Allah is the real owner. And zakah that is required should also be paid. There are various measures that time doesn't allow. This shows how Islam regards wealth, both as individual and collective. And Allah is the ultimate owner. In conclusion, what we see is a topic of human dignity and universal principles is lofty. Islam just did not speak about principles, but also put it into operations and gave guidelines for the implementations. It provided conditions for the legitimate enjoyment of the bounties of Allah, without violation, without excess. And this will not only be mere declarations, but whenever the Muslims were abiding by them, we see that they have given greatest examples of these principles. If they deviated from that, it is their problem. It is not the problem of the Islamic concepts that are founded, after all, in absolute obedience and submission to Allah. With this, I would like to conclude my talk with a verse from the glorious Quran from Surah Al-Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13. Ya ayyuha an-nasu, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَكَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. O mankind, we have made you into nations and tribes so that you may know each other, not that you may despise each other. Verily, the most honored among you in the sight of Allah is the one who is the most righteous. and Allah has full knowledge and is well acquainted with all things. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.